Brothers and sisters, the Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. Luke. Some Sadducees, those who deny that there is a resurrection, came forward and put this question to Jesus, saying, "Teacher, Moses wrote for us, if someone's brother dies, leaving a wife but no child, his brother must take the wife and raise up descendants for his brother." Now there were seven brothers. The first married a woman but died childless. And the second and the third married her, and likewise all seven died childless. Finally, the woman also died. Now, at the resurrection, whose wife will she be? For all seven had been married to her. Jesus said to them, "The children of this age marry and remarry, but those who are deemed worthy of attaining to the coming age and to the resurrection of the dead neither marry nor are given in marriage. They can no longer die, for they are like angels, and they are the children of God, because they are the ones who will rise. That the dead will rise, even Moses made known in the passage about the bush, when he called out, 'Lord, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob.' He is not the God of the dead, but of the living, for to him all are alive." The Gospel of the Lord. We can be eternally grateful, my brothers and sisters, that we are part of the mystical body of Christ, because there will always be somebody who wants to destroy our earthly bodies. In our first reading from the second book of Maccabees, what's happening? The Greeks under Alexander the Great had conquered the known world, and Alexander wants to make the whole world Greek. Greek language, Greek architecture, Greek culture, and Greek gods. Alexander planned it, but never really implemented it because he died too young. It was, however, implemented by his successors. Alexander's successors conform every country that makes up their empire to the Greek system, including Israel. Now you can well imagine that didn't sit well with the Jewish people, especially when it came to the Greek gods part. Some Jews are drastically opposed to it. Some, however, are not. Some not only comply with the new system, they welcome it and praise it. There were Jews who said, "Look, these Gentiles are doing really good. They have an empire. We don't. Well, let's follow their lead. After all, what has God done for us lately? He's allowed us to be conquered by four different pagan empires already. He must have abandoned us, or maybe he never really existed in the first place." And the books of Maccabees chronicle how the people forsook the covenant. Priests were put to death. The temple was desecrated when a statue of Zeus was placed on the altar of holocausts. All books of the law were destroyed, and anybody caught hiding a copy of the law or trying to observe the Jewish dietary regulations were put to death. All of this, and this is what was happening today in our first reading. Faithful Jews choose to surrender their lives rather than surrender their faith. That's the first thing you will find often when studying the history of religions. Many people are far more willing to worship the state rather than God, because the state offers instant gratification, while God offers eternal gratification. And as human beings, we are incredibly short-sighted. This is why Paul says in our second reading, "Pray that we be delivered from confused and evil men, for not everybody has faith." Paul divides people with no faith into two groups, the confused and the evil. The confused are people who just don't know any better. Who are the evil then? Evil people are capable of knowing better, but choose not to. That's why having faith is such an asset. Faith keeps us from getting confused. They don't have the advantage of faith to help them realize that this world is a means to an end and not an end in and of itself. And so they're easily manipulated by the devil. However, faith is not a fail-safe to keep us from becoming evil. Because to be good or to be evil is a choice. People of faith have done many evil things in the name of faith. Terrorists of radical Islam have a profound faith in God and yet have committed acts of unspeakable evil. That is a choice. Because there are many in mainstream Islam, in fact, most in mainstream Islam, condemn acts of violence and terrorism. So these people are capable of knowing better, they choose not to. We can say the same of Christian terrorists, also few in number. But Christians who shoot abortion doctors in the name of Christ, and they use scripture to justify themselves. Phinehas, Moses' nephew, who killed one of his kinsmen who was sinning with a Moabite woman by impaling both of them on his spear. King Saul, whom the prophet Samuel orders to commit an act of genocide. Kill every man, woman, and child of the Amalek people who had grown so evil. And God punishes Saul when he doesn't carry it out. My brothers and sisters, you can pull scripture out of context to justify any sin you want. But that's no excuse for us, because we have the magisterium of the church to interpret scripture and put it into context with the teachings of Christ. So faith, while protecting us from confusion, doesn't necessarily protect us from committing acts of evil. When do people of faith commit acts of evil? When they subsidize their faith with political agenda. So their faith isn't truly in God, but rather the state, because God doesn't offer rewards as the world does. Be very careful, my brothers and sisters, when aligning yourselves with any political party, because both parties bow to different idols. What sets the Christian apart from the rest of the world? We as Christians are promised a physical reward from God, but not a worldly one. There's a difference. When we die, we won't have material riches or temporal power waiting for us. Our reward isn't going to be a worldly one, but it will be a physical one. Because we are members of the mystical body of Christ, because we take Christ physically into our bodies in the Eucharist here on earth, once in heaven, we will share an intimacy with God beyond any worldly union. Our union with God will be a physical one, without being a worldly one. And if you think I'm making this up, look at what Jesus says to the Sadducees in our gospel today. The Sadducees didn't believe in the resurrection of the body. All your rewards you get here on earth. When you die, you go to Sheol, the underworld, the abode of the dead. You go to sleep. That's it. Game over. And so they devise this problem for Jesus about the woman who marries the seven brothers that all die, in turn leaving her childless. And then they ask, so you and the Pharisees believe in the resurrection of the body. Okay then, at the resurrection, whose wife will she be? Jesus points out the question is nonsensical. He states there will be a resurrection of the body, so a physical reality will occur, but we will live in heaven how? Like the angels. Angels are not worldly realities. When we die, we don't become angels. They are beings in and of themselves. They're spiritual realities. The Sadducees don't understand this because they understand worldly rewards only and not spiritual ones. Thank God, my brothers and sisters, thank God that we are members of the mystical body of Christ. Because as we've witnessed in our own world, and as we've heard in our first reading, there will always be confused and evil people who will try to destroy our earthly bodies. The secret to not living in fear or hate or getting discouraged or depressed is by living in this world in physical reality, but all the time keeping our focus on the spiritual realities that God has promised us through Christ. That will help you keep your peace, because you will be constantly reminded that anything at all you suffer here is only assuring you of something better there. And blessed be God forever. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.